Hello everyone, welcome to a new Let's Play on my YouTube channel. This time the game is gonna be Interstellar Space Genesis. It's a turn-based strategy game. 4X says it is mostly inspired by one classic Master of Orion 2. I think I've noticed some influence from other games, including Master of Orion 3. Before starting the Let's Play, I will do the first episode covering how to play the game interface, going to a bit to the game interface and some core game mechanics. For that I will load a game in progress and I'll even show some schematics, but let's first load the game. Okay, so this is what you can expect in a later game. So this is the turn order. It's a turn 155. These are some the main map is here in the center. There's a two-dimensional map. It has let me press one. It has a grid like a chessboard, and in all of these sectors, I think they're called, there can be star systems, and the star systems can have, of course, a star, a couple of planets which are colonizable and terraformable, all of them 100% to your race liking. And the gravity for some races can be made you know, perfect from for some of them cannot, can only fix a bit. And there are also asteroid belts which can be used mostly for sending production toward your planetary colonies. You can also do other sorts of outposts on the asteroid belts. They can help with terraforming, they can give you bits of research, bits of gold if you don't have freighters to do production. But I find production from asteroids, it's I don't know, exploitable, most powerful use of them. I'll go into it later. There are culture perks, there are hero skills that stack up, there are buildings on colonies, all of it stack. And if you focus production from all the belts on a single colony with a single hero, you can get the most out of it. But we'll get back to it. So we are talking about systems. On the start of the game, not all the systems are revealed. There is a sector scanning mechanic. Also the planets, each individual planet can be scanned. By scanning the system, you also scan the planets inside, but scanning the system is slow. There's also a civilian type of ship, it's called a survey ship, that you can move around the various systems. And there's no star lanes or whatever choke points. You can go from each point to every point, barring some obstacles like this thing here. It prevents flying from this is a civilian ship, it's a support ship, it's a type of civilian ship. If I ask it to go here, it will go because it's late game and I have the tech that allows me to cross this. But early game, you'll have to go around like to here, to here, to here. These clouds can hide an indication that you should scan the system. Probably gonna find some hidden planets here. But they also, before certain tech, they slow down traveling through there. So if I go from here to here, it will go through this nebula and slow down travel. This indicator shows if the system has been at the level of scanning I've done to the system. So being late game, I kind of visited everything. This thing, this is the border of supplies where my ships can reach. So that's why these systems don't have the explored areas, because they're outside the capability of my ships to go. So In order to expand this, I need to have outposts or colonies, known systems near it, and will expand. Also, this expands with the logistics technologies. I didn't feel the need in this particular game to go further. One reason to explore, there's no, like in the Civilization 5, there's no closed borders. By default, you can use your fleet to travel to anywhere you have this logistic range. If it covers, you can go, no matter if it's the enemies. Of course, they might precede it as hostiles, they might move fleet to try to intercept and defend in case you want to try something hostile, but otherwise you are encouraged to go and explore each and every system. The way heroes experience work, I clicked on the button. So these are ship leaders. There are two types of leaders you can have. The ship leaders, they are each attached to a ship, and their colony leaders, in this case, are attached to a planet. The ship leaders, you are encouraged to blob them together, all of them in a single fleet, because exploring a new system provides the experience to all the heroes attached to that fleet. Exploring ruins, this thing provides the experience to all the heroes in the fleet. Doing a battle, if you win the battle, they will get the experience. If you flee the battle and they survive, you still get some consolation experience again, share to all heroes. So by blobbing them together, you actually multiply the amount of experience you can get. We'll get to heroes later, but let me just a parenthesis. Here, of course, is the list of colonies, the planets you have. In this particular case, the home world it's I started with is this, Lakewood. This is a planet special. Let's go to... How should I do this? Let me take a break and catch my breath. Okay, I'm back. So this is the galaxy map. Here on top, we've got Empire Gold Generation Economy. We'll go into their breakdown a bit later. This is science, as you'd expect, and there's a new element to, I think Master of Orion 2 didn't have, even 3 didn't have culture. It's more like a more recent development on the gender. Civilization 5 obviously has this. There's some culture perks. You accumulate the cost for each culture perk goes up exponentially. I believe it's next level spatial culture points needed. It's 5,700, 5,700. It would take me 23 turns to reach it with my culture, current culture generation. Here are the ship support points, and this is empire-wide resource. It covers how big your fleet can be without paying extra maintenance. So in order to generate this, you can get them from heroes. If you had many heroes with ship support points, they can grant you ship support points from obviously colonies and some things you can build on the colonies. If you go past it, if you try to go above the number that your empire, current empire size and technology and the heroes and whatever can support, then you start to pay maintenance, and it gives you penalties to production and penalties in combat. So you really, your goal is to try to never go above, unless you know it's late game and you don't care and the economy can take it and you just blobbing up to kill the last AIs. Also, you don't want to be floating too much, because that means you're not actually having a big enough fleet, probably, and the other AIs might take advantage. So, ideally, you want to keep this as a low number, and once you start to get this up, you need to kick up some more military ship. Ships, these ones are strategic resources. They can be used. They have a, once you research one, they give you an alternative tech that you want to have. I don't know, empire development side or military uses, kind of for everyone, each of them. They are, of course, mined from different stars. And the freighters in this game serves two purposes. One of them is, like I said, for those asteroids to concentrate. If you look at these points, all the asteroid belts I'm using, the red are mine. I haven't have a lot of luck in this game, so I started here. This one, you know, it's a block early game. These systems are I took much later, but also they don't have belts. I have a belt here, some belts here. This one, this particular save wasn't a great example. In other games, you'd see tons of game of belts all concentrating on a system, single system, single leader with all the bonuses multiplication to achieve the great effect. I need to take a break because I lost my train of thought. Yeah, I was talking about freighters. So you need freighters to do this. Each route is gonna take a freighter. Also, population migration is an essential mechanic in outgrowing the AIs, and also requires freighters in a roundabout way. If you concentrate like with this lens, when I concentrate production from asteroids on a single planet, migration is sort of geared the same way. You want to concentrate population growth on a single system to big system to grow it out faster. So why do you want two big systems? Let's go to this one. I think it's size 22, one of the biggest I have. So I went past that. We're going inside the colony. This is what the colony looks like. It's got some the list of buildings. They are limited by the current level of infrastructure. Bigger planets get more infrastructure, but don't be fooled by it. Going above 7 on 8 infrastructure, it's gonna take enormous production, so you're gonna waste a lot of turns to increase infrastructure and allow you to get more buildings. Because of that, for most of the time in the early mid game, the buildings you can keep up on your on each planet, or think of them as a deck of cards, basically are not permanent, they are changeable. You're gonna use a temporary space elevator to help you because it gives a bonus to orbital station. To get out on orbital station, then you're gonna turn it up. You're gonna have cloning station that increase growth, but when the planet is filled, you rip that out. You're gonna use once the planet is filled and finished, you might rip up production because you will see that culture and science output on the smaller worlds doesn't really require production, so you're gonna rip those out and put maybe morale, happiness. And the thing is, the core thing is, very few planets are planetary buildings are permanent, and it pays to use the right ones in your hand, so to speak, at the right time, and then you know when to rip up and replace. Even stuff like in Civilization 5 games, you have National College and Hermitage and C5, so there are some capital buildings that provide multiplier on a big producer. Like here, I think I might have technological capital, yeah. And this is a hero with a big research bonus, and the planet might have a special with. So you can move those things. At some point, when your empire grows and you have a new star system, bigger, with, it makes sense to destroy your these national wonders, call them, and move them to the better place. Let's go a bit through to the colony screen. I know there's a lot of numbers here, a lot of things to cover. Let me catch my breath again. Yeah, I think it's time for this schematic, and this is a high level view on the processes and the math that happens on each planetary colony. So in this game, as other games in the gender focus on the system, like Endless Space, I think. It concentrates, it adds together the production in the, from all the planets in the system. Here, it's made on the planetary level, the economy, and then the summation, the empire level summation happens. So some for all planets for resources that are empire wide, like gold and science and culture. Production is a local resource. It's used on each and every planet. So the main resource on the planet, it's the current amount of population. The maximum amount of population you can get on a planet, I'm zooming here so it's readable, depends on the planet size, and some species get bonus to that. If the planet is not properly terraformed, you get a penalty to the size. There's some buildings that can slightly increase it, but that's it. The population, the maximum population a planet can have, is defined by its size mostly. And why is the maximum population on a planet important, and why do we like big planets? Because everything, we have a production chain, we have credits, planetary chain, we have science and culture. All of these are beginning by a multiplication of the, I forget to put the multiplication sign here, but it's multiplication of the number of population on planets. So the bigger a planet, obviously, the bigger output of all those things. In case of production, after you multiply the bonus per population, I'll switch to the game view for a second to show what I mean by some production per population unit here. So I need to hover on the production, and you see there on top 14.25, it's production per population unit on this particular planet at this particular turn. So you've got 6 from the planetary richness. It's a particular to a world. It can be very rich or ultra rich or ultra poor, and anything in between. So you'll have your different production. This is not the best, this is just rich. I think ultra rich gives you 8. Planet improvements, so these are buildings. It's to the right, it's the deep core mine that gives you 2, and space mirror array that gives you 1.5. orbital station, it's another another planetary building, air quotes, that can have extra research made into it to give production. Fusion power plant, so this is the strategic resource. The more of it you have, the more production. This is, I choose the, how should I say, Empire Econ use of the strategic and not the military one. The leader has a skill that can give you production. Space culture, you can have space policy that can give you extra production. Galactic wonders, there is a wonder that gives you extra production on this. On the world as it's built and all the other planets. So that's why I say that's a sum. So there could be even other sources, but in the, on this world, I give you an example. So this is a similar system for gold. So population will have a base, depending on the race, you can have more or less than the leader skills and the wonders and policies and orbital station, and same for science. So this is a leader that gives a big science boost, as you can see, per population. Buildings, that's planetary per computer, that gives +2 and also gives a flat amount. Planet, specials, specials. I think there's a planet type of I could show it. Okay, here, so this unique biota is plus one research point per population in Empire. Okay, back to the general schematic. So we multiply the current population with this amount per population unit. Only in the case of production, the infrastructure level of on the planet, and then there we apply gravity penalty, if any. Of course, later on with technology you can reduce this or eliminate it. For some races you can't really eliminate it, you can only reduce it. This is going to be a penalty to production. And another thing we can see, so the big multiplier for everything, all outputs on the planet, is population. The other big multiplier, the common multiplier, is morale level. So this is big planets with very happy people. It's the secret to winning this game. if this is the only thing you're gonna take from this schematic. Also, production can be taxed, and this taxation it's gonna take from production. It's gonna convert it at a low rate. I'm gonna zoom here, like multiply 0.3 the production that it takes away. It gets turned into credits. There is Empire Wonder, National Wonder, whatever it's called in Civ, that you can build on only one planet. That's what I mean. You can have only one copy and building on a planet, and that will improve the tax conversion rate from 0.3 to 0.35. So this is a way to convert the planetary production into extra credits. We will see later that you can also convert it into population growth. Then we add the flat bonuses. So up to here we have multiplications. We multiply, 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 and here we have at the end some flat additions. There's some buildings, there's some support ships, there's some mining belts, there are mining treaties, there's the planetary might have flat bonuses to any of those resources. So this doesn't help much a well-developed planet with high infrastructure, high population, high morale, where this multiplication factor is going to be huge. So this flat number is going to be very small by comparison. But on new colonies, when you only have one or two population, there's no infrastructure, the morale, it's garbage. It might be an unterraformed world. All of this up to here will be garbage, and you will rely on these flat bonuses to kickstart your new colonies. Not so much early game, but as the game developed, this is the way that helps you kickstart new colonies later in the game. Then we have a... Okay, so there could be an extra multiplier. This is very rare planet special. Some planets give you, I think it's called time dilation, that multiplies all the production on the planet. Then we go on the production sliders. This, I think I'll show it in game better and come back here. Okay, so the production that you get here, so this production, I can reduce it if I raise the tax. Like I said, if I raise tax, you'll see that this one starts to go down, this one will start to go up, because I'm converting production into gold. I'm eating away of the production. You'll see this number here. Here we have some multipliers. Look at the first number, 2621 base production. It's what's coming from the planetary production. Then on the schematic, you'll see that there are some particular multipliers within a reach yet on the production chain. We'll come later. But the base, if I raise tax, this goes down because some of it goes into gold. Okay, the gold goes up. We're receiving from production taxes that number that we taxed here, 426. I am taking away a big chunk of production. The conversion rate is not 1-to-1, it's 30%. This goes to gold, but now the base here, it's reduced because I took away some production, so less production is available on planet to do infrastructure, planetary engineering, or construction. So, and we have three sliders here, so I can how I can divert this production that is left. So I can set it all to infrastructure. I can set it to, I know, 50-50. I can set it in three parts. I cannot in this planet do any more planetary engineering. The planet, it's currently at max population, so I cannot use it to build pop. I cannot use it to improve ecological level because I don't have the tech for it. The planet is terraformed. It's ideal world for this race, so that's why. But let's choose a different planet, perhaps one that is not filled yet. So here all the sliders are open, so you can divert the production, like 391, this 391, in different amounts, and it pays, you know, most of the game it's on this screen. Okay, I don't know, 80%, 85% of the whole gameplay is gonna happen in this area. Just how you split every turn the production into infrastructure, into how much, a bit here, shaving turns to get this faster, or maybe infrastructure faster. Okay, I can get infrastructure for the, okay, maybe I need the ship, maybe I need this is what the sliders are for. And going back to the schematic, okay, so infrastructure, like I said, there is an extra multiplication for infrastructure for the amount of production that you divert towards infrastructure production. There is a specific multipliers for it. There is a technology that gives you 75%, I think, extra multiplier here. And there's also tech, there's a leader skill that also increases infrastructure. So this is not very crucial for low planets that cannot get big infrastructure, and the cost of that infrastructure is low. But for the big forge worlds on your empire, late game, this become crucial to get these bonuses in order to be able to raise your forge world infrastructure high enough, quick enough, because otherwise it will take forever. You'll just keeping your forge world blocked, not doing anything, just upping infrastructure if you don't have the capacity to raise it quickly. So that's why I have this line here. So this output, all of it goes back into infrastructure. So this is one way to the where you can divert your production on the planet at a certain time, just to enhance your infrastructure level. Other ways is to go into the planetary slider. The main way most of the time is gonna be here. Again, there's multipliers that you can get from technologies, from leader, from multiple technologies in this case. And there's also some infrastructure perks. Let's go into them right now. So if I click the infrastructure icon here, you're gonna have some specialization, they call it infrastructure specialization. So for each level of infrastructure built on the planet you reach, you are allowed to pick one of those specializations. And if you finish one of these categories, you get a bonus. This is perhaps the best bonus, finishing planetary engineering. It gives you an empire-wide bonus to planetary engineering. Like you can see here, 165% from infrastructure. So I finished this and it stacks on a lot of planets by this point. So it's not 15%, it's 165%. It's a lot, a lot of planets. It can stack and can help you grow your population on all your planets faster, the ones that aren't maxed yet. It help you increase ecology faster, and can help you terraform faster. So it's a stacking bonus. The civil engineering has like two lanes. This one makes your allows you to build more buildings. Then you have infrastructure, you get a bonus building. Also lowers the maintenance cost of the planetary buildings. They do cost money to keep up. This one gives you also, all of them have provide some bonus to research, to a particular part of research. We're going to research a bit later. It's not a huge part, and that's why I let it for later. This bonus for finishing planet energy it's great. On tiny planets that can only get three infrastructure, you probably cannot afford the luxury. But anything but that, and if it's not a special world like the home world, you cannot have the luxury to make this. On most planets, you would want to make max this. This is one of the weaker bonuses, but it's also a source for ship support points. As you can see, I'm not lacking ship support points at this point. This is must. Gives you multiplying bonus here when production ships, an extra multiplier to ship production is 20%, 30%, 40%. Absolutely necessary on your home world, which is gonna do most of your ship building, you know, early game, and then on your forge worlds, they will need this maxed. Small worlds, obviously, you will want this line maxed, because it allows you to put more buildings there, increases the what you can do with planetary buildings. And this is something I almost never use, this left line bonus to production building. Perhaps if you have big world later in the game and it's got, I don't know, it's got poor ultra poor production, so it's gonna be hard to bring up all the buildings, but it's kind of temporary bonus. And the finisher here, it gives you extra production, extra flat production, I think, to buildings. Very trash building, and it is divided by the number of colonies. So later on, when you can actually afford the luxury to get this, because this is much more useful. This having 9 infrastructure, it's gonna be very late game. You're gonna have a ton of colonies by then. That doesn't even work properly. It will work in some colonies, probably works on all of them, but it only applies to building buildings. So if you're building something else, you're not gonna see it. Same here, finishing all of this provides a tiny bonus to your capital. By the time you can finish this, your capital is not gonna be your. Not gonna matter, again divided by the number of colonies, it's poor. So the finisher here, it's trash. The finisher here is trash. This one is great. The finisher is great, you want it everywhere. Back to the schematic. So there's three ways you can use the planetary. So if you choose to divert production into the planetary, we call them planetology, whatever, production queue, like I said, there's also a multiplier here. There's three main ways to use this. One, and there's some drop downs for you to choose. You cannot use another pyramid to divert. Here, you must choose one of them at a particular time between these three. The main one you're going to use most of the time is the main growth multiplier. I'll go into population growth in a bit, but this is like the main source for it, okay? And that's why having a good production on planet will also, and having it rich, good mineral richness on the planet is gonna be here in this sum of bonus per unit. It's gonna allow you to manufacture more population on that planet. It's a bit intuitive, but that's how it works. Another way to do this is to send it to increase the ecology level on the planet, and that has the effect of, again, increase growth to a certain amount, and also increase morale. And morale, you know, it will increase production, and production will increase this. It's cycles. The ecological level cannot be raised above level 3. If you raise it to level 3 before you terraform, you won't be able to terraform the world, and also you require technologies to do this. All of them are unlocked by technology, so you need level 1, level 2, level 3 in the tech tree, and the planets might already start a certain ecological, so you're not going to do a lot of this. But when you can do it, it pays to do it ASAP. And it's a powerful effect. And the third one, it's terraforming. So terraforming, it's here, improve the biome. What's the effect of terraforming? Again, growth. If the planet is not fully populated, you know, do this, both of these, it pays to do this. Sooner, the lower the current population on the planet, the better return you're gonna get on the growth. When the planet is filled, it doesn't grow anymore. So it's kind of these benefits become useless. And again, growth. Terraforming gives you it gets double effect in population growth, so it really pays to do this early. And something I'm not showing on this schematic is that it removes penalty to population, to planet, yep, maximum population on planet, planet size, planet population size, so to speak. And so this, even if the planet is filled, it still pays to do the terraformation, because you'll increase the amount of population multiplier for all of the outputs, and also you increase the capacity, then you can grow some more. So even if the planet is nearly filled or filled, it's not the end of the world to terraforming that. But ideally you do it early, you have the technology and the planetology muscle, this multiplier here. You need this in order to terraformation, and I think ecological, but in terraformation and this infrastructure, I think they scale with the planet size. So on the huge planets, you really need these special multipliers, you know, from technology, from leaders later in the game, to actually be able to do them in a time scale that it's, you know, relevant. There's also some flat bonuses, but these flat bonuses are shit, so to speak. So maybe they can help a bit a isolated crab colony on this forge worlds, on your top worlds. This is not going to matter. This is where it's at. We need the multipliers. And you can also use this to production, construction. The slider in construction. And construction is going to be for buildings. And also, there's multipliers, like I said, for infrastructure, for building production, the planetary buildings. The number is limited, but like I said, it pays at times because of the limited number of slots to put infrastructure to rip up building, build another one. So maybe it's relevant for a longer time. And of course, building ships. Ships are not going to build just everywhere. You're going to build on the planet that have the multiplier for shipbuilding, and it's going to be your forge world, your home world, except maybe there's a race that starts with a really shit home world, but even there, and then it's going to be forge worlds, the biggest, richest, you know, you're going to funnel population there, you're going to make it grow fast, and you're going to give it the shipbuilding multipliers, and that's going to be where you're going to make your fleet. And so this is not a loop, this is just, well, the planetary buildings, if we are to be honest. I'm not going to, I haven't even put buildings here, but yes, put a type of buildings, and buildings also affect at various points. So you can, they have extra production, they can have extra credit, extra science for sure, extra culture, and some of them have multipliers. I haven't shown this because this would become overly complicated, but yes, imagine a building here that has various injects in various points here. And the ships are how should I say, empire-wider, not local. They can travel the galaxy and, you know, have various effects that way. And here there's this line. In the production queue, you can make trade goods, and that's another conversion of production. So it's not the tax. If we look here, the tax kills the production that you can put into this, so it lowers stuff you can do with these things. This is a secondary conversion of production to gold. It has a poorer rate, 1.25 by default. But if the planet is finished and it's not a ship builder and stuff, and you don't want a micro building, planetary buildings with bonus, and or ships with ship building bonus, and then scrapping them, because scrapping also has the same rate. But if you build it with a multiplier, you know, you kind of get a better rate. If you don't want to do all that crappy micro build scrap, you just set it to building trade goods, and that's going to give you some tiny bit of extra gold. Okay, that was the production chain. The others are much simpler. So the credits, again, you have per unit, you know, base of depending on the empire. If humans and the Seric Sentinels get bonus, there's some galactic events, there can be buildings, whatever, you get it's a sum. You multiply the number of population, you multiply by morale, as you know, you add what you get tax from production, if you have tax, and then there's some flat bonuses. This is usually planet special. It's some planets that give you 40 credits, 60 credits. It can help cover extra planet cost in the beginning, can offset. If the planet is not terraformed, the building cost is multiplied, so it's really crippling to your economy early to try and colonize planets that are on the wrong terraform level for you, for your species. That's that. And then there's economic efficiency and planet special that can make multiply the amount of gold, very rare. And that's it. It goes to the Empire Treasury, and there's some other sources there, like trade treaties with other empires, the outposts that can make money. But the outpost, you really should be making production with them, not money. In my opinion, there's a piracy, leader skills, basically. They can steal money from other empires, and other empires can pirate money from you. There's smuggling, strategic resources, you can trade them, you can sell some of them. There's even technology that increases. It's a drop in the bucket, in my opinion, compared to what you can get from this, from the planet, from the sum of the planet production. Just grow your empire, make the planets big, make them happy, and they're gonna give you everything. Production, money, science, culture. The other sources are, maybe it's the map size that I'm playing it, that those sources are a bit less compared to this. This is the core of the game. Same for science. Okay, it's gonna be some. There's definitely a planetary building you will want to have on all planets that are, you know, a bit bigger, two extra per point and a flat amount later, of course, morale increasing everything. And there's also special building, the technological capital that multiplies by two. So you're gonna put this on your best science world if you have room for it, because the amount of buildings limited. And there's also special research efficiency, very rare planet that can give you extra science on the planet. And same for culture, exactly same. There is a cultural capital, you research it, you build it on the right planet. Later on, when a better planet comes along, you know, rip it up, rebuilding there. Very straightforward. Let's go a bit into into population growth. How does your population increase on a planet? Okay, so ignore this for a second, immigration and emigration. There's a base growth. I'm gonna show you a different graphic very soon. There's a base growth that depends solely on the current planet size and the amount of population is on the planet. And there's a sum of multipliers, of which the biggest one, so the racial one is here. As the later in the game doesn't have that much impact, like minus 50%, plus 50%, whatever. the big source is gonna be this, the middle arrow, planetology. This is gonna be like, to this multiplier is gonna be like 6 or 7, so the ratio one is 0.5 compared to 7, you know. So later in the game they don't matter as much. Early in the game they're important. Once you know, make a big planet population producer, this it's the main source of increasing population growth. This thing, what is base growth? It's a very simple graph. I'm gonna show it right away. Okay, so on this axis we have the current population. Wait, yep, on this axis we have the current planet size divided by 2, so the half of the planet size. The bigger the planet, on this axis we have the base growth per turn. Okay, so as the, let's look at the red line for example. As the planet fills up, it starts to grow more population per turn. If the maximum population growth happens when it's half full, and then as the planet fills up, the rate of population generation goes down. And when the planet is empty, near empty, so the beginning, it's gonna grow very slowly, and once it's filled again, it's gonna stop growing. This from here to here, so like, I don't know, 30% to 80%, 20% to 80% is the part of filled. So for currently the population on the planet, it's the part where it generates more population, more precisely here near when it's half filled. You're supposed, the game heavily encourages you to enable migration during this support part on the planet's fill. Just a second. So how can you increase the amount of population a particular planet generates? By increasing the planet size. So here, if I build a building that increases by 2, it's gonna generate more pop. It's a higher curve. If I terraform the planet, I remove a penalty that made it be smaller. It allows to grow bigger, to make more population. You are encouraged to export population while the planet it's in its growth cycle, and once it reaches here, you're supposed to, if it's a good planet, it's a forge world, you wanna fill quick, then you turn on migration and bring population from the other planets here to max it. Once it's maxed, it's out of the migration cycle. The population, it's stuck there, it doesn't grow, it doesn't go down. For some reason the game allows you to enable migration from a filled world, but it will generate next to zero pop, so it's a trap. You emigrate from planets that are low, so nothing for the base population growth, nothing else matters but the planet size and how much population is currently on it. So going back here, that's that graph where the base it's calculated, then by terraforming you increase planet size, and that's why I showed this. But some buildings also increase planet size. One of the species allows you to have bigger planets, kind of special subterranean, that 50% more population on the planet. So that, all of this affects this, the base growth, and then there's these multipliers. You have technologies, you have the racial, some races have some minor bonuses or penalties to growth, and then the big chunk comes from, like I said, from production, funnel into planetology, using these big multipliers that you can acquire later in the game. You do this to habitat building or something, and it allows you to grow really, really fast, to produce a lot of population. Now this population, you know, it gets back here, or you can emigrate to other planets that need it more. Population unit, it's worth more on a big world with high infrastructure than on a small world that cannot get big infrastructure and maybe not get big morale because you will not have room for the morale buildings and stuff like that. And maybe it's a poor world that has bad resources, mineralogy, then you can send it to a big one with ultra rich. All of this, the same one population unit can make, I don't know, I'm exaggerating, maybe 3,000 production on the star world, and will make 3 production on the shit world. So it pays to move that one population of shit world to the star world. That's what migration is for. Now, immigration, it's how you bring population to help your star worlds grow quicker. And the thing about it, there is no cap. If you concentrate immigration from a ton of population donors to your star world, the one you're trying to fill up at a particular time, allows you to grow by multiple population units per turn. Let's go in game. Okay, so this star here means, and this red numbers tells me that these planets are actually emigrating population at the moment. So if I click here, it's gonna show me that I'm losing 50% of the population generation it's sent to another place. And if you try to emigrate to multiple places at once, it is divided, the amount of population is divided to all destinations, so it pays to only set migration to a single planet at a certain point, so you fill that planet as fast as possible. And so that's what a population donor looks like. So in this particular case, I have, I think, 2 active. I might be a filter here. Yeah, in this particular case, I have 2 active. That's near the end of the game. I think this turn I end the game by having way more population than the AI, so there's a planet vote and I have so much population that I win, even though my fleet isn't the best. And as you would expect, having these floating support points not used, and even my culture isn't the best. Going back here, the population receiver in this case, as you can see, it's a big world, ultra rich. This is what you want to feel. The gravity, yeah, I'm building the anti-gravity generator very late. It's a penalty, it's a multiplier to production. But the population received, if I think you can look at this screen, but even better on the hover. I'm not receiving a lot. So this is not a great example on what immigration can do. It's just mechanically how you set it up. So you export from donors that are on their peak population growth and send it up, concentrate it to a large rich planet that you want to fill up quickly. Once the planet is filled up, it's gonna have enough production to hopefully up infrastructure, I don't know, 8-9, and that is gonna really crank up production on this world. That's it about Migration, will I talk about anything else? Okay, a few words about special abilities. Yeah, special abilities for the race. They obviously, some of them are very powerful, some of them not so much. And this thing, the search grid, like I said, you need to, some of the systems are hidden at the start of the game, and also the planet richness and stuff like ruins, where you can get various bonuses. You can get ships, you can, you always get experience for your hero, you get for all your heroes, so blob them, you can get money, you can get special technologies, you can get other heroes, more heroes. So it pays to, that's why it pays to explore all the galaxy. And there are some cultural traits here that can help you scan, you know, twice faster, and even get a bonus to the scan speed. You'll see it in game. I don't know, I'm not a master of scanning or exactly where to scan and how to get the best out of it. It's a mechanic, it's relevant, it can have great returns. We'll see more about it in game. The Empire overview shows you some nice graphs here, how you are compared to the others. So I was behind in technology most of the game. I'm barely catching up with the tech leader. Production wise, I was way above the AIs. From, you know, turn 100 or something, I'm beginning to pull ahead. Fleet wise, I was ahead at some point, then I fall behind. I'm trying to keep up. It's important to keep up, because otherwise the AIs will come and attack you, and you know, flip your belts and invade your worlds and make a mess of things. Population, this is where you can, with using migration properly, you can really leave AIs in the dust, if you know they don't kill you in combat, on this difficulty level at least. It's sovereign, it's not the hardest. Culture wise, yeah, this is a culture bonus trace, I think. Culture, yeah, the Multars. I'm kind of struggling, and the overall place. So that's the Empire overview, and here you can change the color of your empire. You can make your empire, you know, green. Now my empire is green, and my fleets are green, and everything is green. And you can change the color for the other empires as well. So if you are at war with someone, you can make your empire green, make them red. If there's two empires you have difficulty distinguishing from, you can also do it. I think you can click on him and give him a different color. Okay, I hate you, be red. And now he is red on the map. Can recognize it. Boy, the research screen. I need to catch my breath on that one. We'll get back. Ship design. I'm not gonna say much, only that ship has auto updated hyperdrive. On small ships, it is easy to increase strategic tactical combat speed, and that increases your chance to hit, and your ship defense makes you harder to hit. But this one scales with hull size. So on the bigger ship, it costs you more firepower, way more firepower to increase this. So the big ships are going to be slow and sluggish, and the small ship is going to be relatively cheap firepower wise to make them more nimble. Armor. So this is applied automatically once you get a new technology from whatever source. Armor, you know, cheap hit points, you can add a bit more at the cost of production. I think for this you need to refit the ship though, if you get better tech. And shields, of course, you can opt to go without shields completely, not that I would recommend it. Or yeah, I haven't researched lots of shields here. You can choose if you have a sniper ship that sits on the back, on the back line, and it has a long lot of range. You can, I don't know, maybe make some more space by removing some shields. But if the enemy has teleporting ships or fast ships, might not be worth it. Might be worth it if by doing this you free up enough room to put enough firepower to kill them before they get close. So, you know, trade-off. As you go up in hull size, the shields will occupy more and more firepower. So maybe on bigger ships it might be pay off to use older shield tech that is gonna have more miniaturization and allow you to free more room up for firepower. A special system works the same way. You have battle pods. This one just gives a flat 25% space available bonus. So this is like kind of must. Once you have the production for it, all ships should have it. It should be like by default. But the other ones, just like with the engine speed, the special systems also increase in space by the hull size. What do I mean hull size? Frigate, destroyer, battleship type. So adding a special system on big ships is gonna consume, it's gonna waste a lot of firepower. So you really, really, really don't wanna put a special system on your big ships unless you unless it's really worth it. So you need to think hard. And of course you're gonna have your weapons with modifiers and miniaturization. Miniaturization is basically, I'm going to the research tree. How many the tech level, right? If I'm like tech level 4 and laser it's tech level 1, that means I'm 3 techs ahead of the laser, so I'm miniaturization level 3. I think the max is level 5. At that point you don't get any extra benefit for researching further. Miniaturization allow your old tech to you know, be improved. It will consume less space, so you can fit more of it and compete with the latest technologies that don't have miniaturization and occupy, waste a lot more space. So, and since all weapons have the same base range, because some of them have some multiplier bonus or penalty, but by default all of them have 25 range. So yeah, laser is not something you research, you start with, and as soon as you get the new technology, it's obsolete. Usually you can get mileage out of old weapon better than the other ones. Another thing is, even if you have, I don't know, similar maximum damage output, comparing, I don't know, 50 lasers compared to 3 graviton flux, I'm making up, but the thing is, with 3 graviton flux group, weapon group, you get 3 rolls to hit, okay? So just a bad roll and you've lost 30% of your damage. With lasers you got 56 rolls to hit, 56 laser, 56 rolls to hit. So it's gonna be more accurately statistically represent the chance to hit. It's not gonna have not gonna be easy to lose high chunks of your damage to unlucky roll. Even if you unlock your roll 3, 4, 5 lasers out of 56, you're still gonna do most of your expected damage with miniaturized weapons instead of the latest and the greatest. And that's all I had to say about ship design. We're gonna go more about it in game. Early game, you do not have the, how should I say, the chance to hit for direct fire weapons, and missiles are gonna be, missile blow spam is gonna win for you. it's going to be more effective later on when you can stack up chance to hit from technologies, from heroes, from ship module, again technologies. It pays missiles, they have limited ammunition. Direct fire weapons have unlimited ammunition for long engagement. They start to be superior also. They can have ability so they're affected by just a second. Okay, so most direct fire weapons are affected by chance to hit dissipation at range, and also fall off, and also damage fall off. For some weapons, it's only one of them. For some of them, it's both. So you really must really get close for them. You can mitigate to some extent using weapon mods, but you need late game tech and leaders and stuff to really make them work. Early game, it's for missile, and I think I've wasted enough time with ship design. We'll go also another thing early game. If you get assaulted by the AI, it pays to have many tiny ships you can send and try to flip as many belts of the enemy's outposts as possible. If you only have big ships, a few big ships, you cannot be everywhere at once. You don't need to have firepower, you just need to have the ability to project, to hit in many places at once. So another advantage of small ships. Like I said, the other one is that modules don't waste so much firepower. On special modules, don't waste so much firepower on small ships than on big ships. So it pays to put some modules on smaller ships. I'm thinking maybe the iron discharger, the one that disables ships, you can put it on the small, I think on a cruiser it would fit, and it doesn't waste that much firepower there. And oh no, that's a weapon. That's wrong. Special weapons, they occupy the same space on all ship sizes. You would pay to put on a cruiser just because a cruiser, if you use the cruiser and you can hit a Titan, for example, if the enemy has bigger ships, yes, it's worth it to use a small ship to disable a big one. But on the amount of space wastage, special modules, I don't think I have researched that many of them. Like, this is a hero thing that allows your hero to survive if your ship gets destroyed. Pays to keep your heroes that don't have combat ship bonuses, to keep them on smaller ships and waste less firepower that way. This, and there's holodeck again, a similar module, allows them to get extra experience on the ship. Okay, enough of the ship design. Diplomacy, here you can have a list overview of bonuses and penalties based on your actions. You can have treaties, mining treaty. Trade treaty, this gives you money. The mining treaty allows you to occupy belts in their system. So as soon as you occupy all your belts, there's basically no penalty to this. They cannot, there's no more belts for them to outpost in your, well, they could colonize some of the worlds that you haven't got out to, and that's a risk. Can they colonize though, or just get asteroid belts? But what, it's a big bonus to your starting colonies. It's that flat amount of production. And there's also, you can do a research treaty, and then you can do alliance and stuff, and also you can trade strategic resources, and it pays to gobble them up because they are multipliers to production or ship damage, so, and population growth and so forth. So it pays to, as soon as your economy allows it, it pays to gobble all of them up. Would be nice if just by hovering here will tell you what resources they have available to sell and what treaties you're able to do with them without having to open this and click and waste a lot of time this way. But that's for the suggestion box. And the leader screen, Okay, there's two type of leaders, the one set up to ship, like I said, pays to blob them all out. There's also the spying thing. If you have particularly good spies, they can get good experience. It pays to build them the spy building on some planet on your empire, so they can do spy stuff quicker. But it's kind of limited. Okay, I'm back. So spying, sometimes it pays early game if the chance to for the operation is not 100%. Not worth it. If you're playing against the Xeric Sentinel, you need to have a bit of cash to buy back your agent in case it gets caught, and also you need to be confident that you're not gonna piss them off. And even if the chance to detect is zero, they have a special ability to catch your spies, and that when that happens, you need to have the cash to buy the hero back, and also it can lead to war with the guys. So things to consider if you're gonna attempt this spy operations or not. But on to the skills command, pretty straightforward. Like I said, if they don't have skills like this tactician that makes it move faster on the tactical side, or I don't know, his skill 30% weapon damage, stuff like that, it pays to keep them on small ships, because their leader special modules will waste less firepower, they'll occupy less space. And but if they have a lot of command and they have desire to command a bigger ship, then you should let them have it and increase their opinion. And opinion, if you satisfy the request, it's a multiplier to the amount of experience they get, so they will level up quicker, and you want that. That's command. Put him on the ship where he can get a big experience, but don't pump it unless it's he has combat related skills. It's not worth it. On the whole fleet, only one, the attack of the highest attack applies, and the highest defense from a different leader. So you're gonna pump defense on one guy, you're gonna pump attack on another guy. Here we have a genius. The genius doubles your, so absolutely this is gonna be the defense of the attack, the genius of the whole fleet. So no point putting defense on any of the other guys. Same with attack, the highest attack, you keep pumping attack and the others don't touch it. Initiative, I tend not to touch it. I think it can allow you to move further in the first round, and sometimes that's all you need. If you have a ship with good range and you have a bit of initiative, you start the combat here, you make your first round jump, like maybe overload your engine because it doubles the movement, and you have an initiative bonus that's double too. So if in the first round you can bring your big ship here, like the middle of, then you can control the whole battlefield from there. So it pays too, as one learns more about, more confident about the tactical combat on the ships. This becomes important to get to a center level. And what is left, the dump skill, the dump stat for all your heroes is operations. Operation gives you ship support points, and it's very valuable that way. Allows you to have a huger fleet without paying extra maintenance or combat penalties. And on the skills, explorer, it's very good to have at least an expert explorer that allows you to milk ruins a second time. The skill, the explorer skill, stacks from multiple heroes, and you also get 10% bonus to ruin a reveal chance from having a survey ship. And later in the game, of course, when you have this big blob, you'll have 100% to always pop ruins. So there are some skills that apply to the fleet, like this navigator applies to Starmat speed to all your ships everywhere, military, civilian, but there's It pays to have only one. And there's some skills that apply to his ship only, and like I said, there's this stat that apply to the whole fleet. Enough about these guys. The colony leaders, they tend to stand on a colony, or you send them abroad early game if you don't have enough colonies and they have spy skills, you can send them to gain some experience that way. How do they gain experience? I think I went through it, exploring system, exploring ruin, going into battle. If they win, they get more. If they on the ship, they get more, 25% more. If they run from the battle, they get less. But that's how they get experience. If you put a module on the ship, the holodeck, get a bit more experience. The colony leader, they get experience from building, finishing planetary planets. If you build goods on the planet, so perma building goods transfer, the planet is finished, it has max population, max final buildings, nothing else to do there, you put it to make gold, the leader is not gonna grow anymore, it's not gonna learn anything. If on a planet that's building population, that leader again, it's not learning anything. They get experience when you build ships. I think it's 1 XP per hull size. They get experience for building buildings, and the big chunks is for planetary projects like terraforming and ecology levels. That are the big chunks for level up. And I need to look at infrastructure, because it's not so intuitive. The low levels are easy to get, but the high levels are expensive. I don't know if it's skills, the experience, I should check, or not. Their skills, administration, not vital in my opinion. Labor is the vital skill, the most important skill to have on your forge worlds, something like this. The research, this is you're gonna put on a world with bonus research, and the technological capital, you're gonna try to have this hero. Otherwise, it's bonus but not huge, same about with administration, bonus not huge. Corporate, it's trash skill on all your heroes except one, the belt god. In this particular let's play, like I said, started in a corner, didn't have access to many belts, so my belt god is kind of pitiful, only 60% bonus. But if you start on, if you look out on the map and you get a ton of belts, then the belt god, where he's gonna receive all the belts, all the asteroid production belts, it's gonna hugely amplify that production, and it's gonna get that world quickly to max population, max infrastructure, at which point his services will be no longer required on that world. You will want a high labor hero moved in there, ideally with the extra infrastructure skill to help take it the last of the way. And this labor on huge worlds start to overtake even a big corporate with many belts, because this is additive, this is adds at the end, this is multiplicative labor. So on the developer, the labor will win, will need to replace him. This guy doesn't become obsolete though, your belt god, you just simply move him to a huge new world that's perhaps bad terraformation, bad morale, everything, doesn't care. The flat bonuses are just added, they ignore morale, penalty, gravity, anything. They just kickstart the world, being a huge chunk of production with him is gonna make that world, raise it very quickly. So that's the goal of the one and only belt god. If you happen to during the gameplay have to get access to a higher corporate skill hero, this one then becomes regular heroes, you start pumping corporate, you start putting into labor, and you know, replace him with the new belt god. The other hero, skill warfare, this is the least important, I think. Actually, the guy with the highest warfare skill in your empire is where you should park your fleet. There's also something like this. It has a similar icon, but it's a different skill. It increases the experience for your ship crews. Not your ship leaders, your ship crews. They also get experience. And that also allows them bonuses in combat. Higher chance to hit, higher defense, so less likely to be hit, boarding bonuses, stuff like that. I don't know that I have. No, this is morale, yeah, very important, the morale, as we've seen on that scheme, the multiplier, many happy people, and every high output. The rest of the things, not so great. This medicine skill, like I said, additive, important early, loses value later in the game. This is a spy skill. Activist again, powerful early, loses strength as the game goes on. And this is the big skill, the infrastructure, coupled with high lever. So this is what you need to get your what's called Forge Worlds up to speed. And morale also very, very powerful, very useful. That's what you look at, but. Normally you try, I don't use so this I just click the high tax just to illustrate how it works. Yeah, I tend to roll with low tax most of the game, past the early game, to have gold reserve. It allows you to rush by buildings, allows you to recruit all heroes you come across. It allows you to choose usually best outcomes of intergalactic events, so it pays to have a gold reserve. I haven't touched on research, and I think it's a special conversation. Both research and culture, I'll just say this, they can be, they have two big parts. No. If I hover it on it, it's what you get the sum from colonies being the main part, and then you get some from research, from outpost, same, I don't think there's a culture outpost, but for research there is. And the other part is you can convert your gold income into, at a rate of 2 to 1, 50%, right, to science. On empire level, so all the gold you get, you can convert it to up to 100% of your income. You can send it at this conversion rate of 50% to science, and depending on how much you actually generate, you can, if the economy is strong, you can end up making more science just from gold than from the rest of your generation, so they add. And the same can be done with culture. And with the caveat that the conversion rate for culture, from gold to culture, it's worse. It's 0.25, not 0.5, 0.25. It's way worse. But it can help you reach a certain policy or technology faster, but I tend not to do that. And also, if you raise empire tax and you increase your income, then this is gonna add a lot more. You're gonna tax, you're gonna fuel more here. So now I'm getting more science from gold than from the rest of the science resources. I don't recommend doing it much. I don't think it's the best. It's what I tend to do. And I think I blabbered enough. I think I'm gonna end this here, and I'm gonna start the let's play in the next episode.